It is truly an honor and a rare privilege to get to speak to the community that I love so much and that has given so much to me. What I want to talk about this morning is really hasn't departed much from the very first breakfast 14 years ago. We had a two-year hiatus when we lost our director, and Jericho Partnership filled in, which I'm very grateful for. The original breakfast show was Pete Scalzo and his daughter put it on, and the Chavalas, and Diane Sanders took it from there, and they've done tremendous work. So the very first breakfast, I talked about really two purposes for the breakfast. One is to elevate the decision making in our community, really try to transform communities through the decisions we make. I think studies are showing we make something like 35,000 decisions every day. Not all of those. In fact, most don't have moral significance. I don't think the color of your socks has a lot to do with the quality of your day. But a lot of them do. And to the extent we take the high road, the middle road, or the low road, it really has an impact on those around us. A high road might be something that Mother Teresa would decide to do. The middle road is you or me on our best day, on a good day. And the low road is the decisions we make on a bad day for us. For me, that's when I'm, whiny, impatient, self-absorbed, and just a little touch of arrogance, right? It's not where you want to be. But the extent that we can influence the decision-making of each person every day, we make our business places and our communities a better place. The other purpose was to elevate the role of faith within the community. Faith is a tremendous help and assistance for us in making moral decisions, making more ethical decisions. The culture is something that I'm passionate about in building healthy cultures. I've had some success at work, although I'm reminded of the metaphor someone gave me once about leadership. They said, if you're the top monkey in the tree, when you look down, you see a lot of smiling monkey faces looking up at you. But if you're lower down in the tree and you look up, you get a different view. So I say with some reservation that we've been successful in building a healthy culture. When I think about the things that shaped me in that passion, I have to go back to my upbringing. And really my parents, like many of us I'm sure, are the greatest influence in my life. My dad is a very interesting person. He had a really horrible start to life before his aunt and uncle rescued him. And he did well after that. He went to St. John's of Divine Choir School, Columbia University, and then became a Navy diver. He was in EOD, Explosive Ordnance Disposal, which is one of the most dangerous jobs on the planet, disarming mines and torpedoes, diving on wrecks, and that kind of thing. He was a man's man. He was an athlete. He'd walk into a room and just light it up. Everybody loved my father. My mother was a nurse. One of the most compassionate, kind, and caring people you'll ever meet. And they love to create environments. And my dad, when he did something, he never did it in a small way, he did it in a big way. The first house, only house he actually ever owned, was a house he bought in Brewster, New York. It was the oldest house in Putnam County, had not been lived in for 5 years before he bought it, built in 1719, and it was a wreck. We spent a lot of our weekends growing up, working on this house. It was the kind of house, if you've ever been in an antique or lived in one, you know that nothing's level or flat or parallel or perpendicular. The ceilings upstairs were about 5'11". Actually, it went from 5'8", probably to 6 feet tall, and you had to kind of walk this way. And every once in a while, you'd forget why you walked that way, and then you'd remember. There was a tremendous amount of work to do at the house and a typical weekend job. My dad had fun jobs and weekend jobs. Right? As near as we could tell, fun jobs were jobs that were supposed to take a few hours and weekend jobs were jobs that were supposed to take a weekend. We never had a fun job that lasted less than a month and weekend jobs would become careers. So a typical job might go something like this. My dad would get us up in the morning and say, "Boys, today we're going to change linoleum in the entryway bathroom." And my friends and I, by the way, we're sort of a roving workforce, so we'd all call each other and determine who had the easiest job that week. And changing linoleum seemed pretty easy, so all the friends would come over to our house. And first thing, you know, you pull linoleum up, and my first thing, Dad says, gee, it's wet under here. Must have a leak somewhere. And it looks like it's been leaking for a while because these floorboards are rotten. So now we're pulling up floorboards and discover that underneath that are 2x4s that are kind of twisted and warped. He goes, oh, that's why the laundry room sags next door. If we get some house jacks, we can jack this up, sister up some 2x10s. We can level the whole thing out. And that 60-year-old wiring in there, gee, I can see copper. We better change that. So now we've got the bathroom fixtures in the entryway, debris outside, we'll be tearing into walls. That's when my mother gets home and says, Alan, we're having company over tonight. We all remember when my dad decided it was too expensive to heat the house with oil. This house is an old salt box, if you can picture it, a long roof on one side, a narrow one on the other. It had been added on to over the years, so it was sort of L-shaped, and one of the L's had its own heating. But the main body of the house was probably, I don't know, 2,700 square feet. And he determined that we could heat this place, 2,700 square feet, with one wood stove stuck on one end of this L. And it was not unusual for it to get down to high 30s, low 40s in our bedrooms at night. My parents actually got dressed up to go to bed, which is why I think I've only got three brothers instead of more. But to heat the house with wood, of course, you need wood. And typical dad fashion, he created an event out of it. And we had what's called Wood Day. I've never been very good at naming things. My company's a network support company. We're going to cut wood. We had Wood Day. That's what we do. So the first one, we had a couple of friends over, and we worked really hard. But one day, we cut down trees, cut them up. I see some people here who've been at Wood Day. Cut them up, hauled the wood out of the woods, split it, stacked it, 3.5 cords of wood in one day. It was hard work. But it was great. My mom was there. She'd made great food, made everybody feel welcome. Well, over the years, this became an event. It grew to 40 or 50 people. We'd have people show up with the chainsaws they used once a year and their flannel shirts they wore once a year, and they'd bring their pickup trucks and their shiny new malls. And my mom would make great food, and it became just a party. And Wood Day was a lot less work when we were having fun doing it with our good friends and neighbors. And at the end, you could see what you created. You had a shed stacked beautifully with 3.5 cords of wood. And of course, my dad was very happy because he knew we could heat the house for the winter. Interesting thing about that is that he had created a culture in that event. And I think we all know that work, when you're working with friends, when there's great values there, is very different than when it's not. I've asked over the last several months a lot of business owners, a lot of managers, a lot of employees, I've said, what do you find? What's the role of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, forgiveness, and love in the workplace? Employees are pretty quick to say, yeah, I think they're there. Managers and owners take a little longer probably to respond. But it's clear that no one's ever really thought deeply about that or about it much at all. Oh, well, work's work, right? You go to work, you do stuff. And what really brings home the value of those virtues is when you think about the opposite. If you think about compassion, let's look at the left side. Let's make a list on the left side, all those virtues. Let's put the opposite on the right side. So in the workplace, you can have compassion or you can have cold-hearted indifference. Well, you want to be on the left side, right? You can have kindness or you can have cruelty. You can have humility or you can have arrogance, egotistical, driven behavior, prideful behavior. You can have patience or impatience, anxiety. You can have compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, gentleness, harshness, forgiveness or unforgiveness, bitterness, resentment, love, hate, selfish behaviors. But we don't want to live on the right side. It's very clear. You want to live on the left side. And I think it's worth us all spending some time thinking about where do those things belong in the workplace. What's interesting is that there's been a lot of study on this recently. It's done in the form of employee engagement. I'm sure many people have heard this term recently. It probably grew up about 10 years ago. And employee engagement has to do with where your employees put their discretionary effort. And studies show that an actively engaged employee is 3 times more productive than an actively disengaged employee. So this has got the attention of businesses, right? Because you all want more productive employees, you want to be more profitable. I would say that's the wrong focus, but because you're able to monetize it, it's gained a lot of attention. So how does that work? If you think of a rowboat, your actively engaged employees are rowing hard, your disengaged employees are sitting on the benches as passengers, and your actively disengaged employees are filling holes in the bottom of the boat. And studies have shown that an actively engaged employee is, in an 8-hour day, gets about 12 hours of work done because they're choosing to use their discretionary effort to work hard. A disengaged employee, you get about 8 hours in an 8-hour day. An actively disengaged employee, you get about 4 hours worth of work at an 8-hour day. So it's like 12 hours versus 4, 3 times more productive. That has a huge impact on the bottom line. And the number one driver, interestingly, of employee engagement is how employees answer one simple question. And the question is, does management care about me? Particularly my direct manager, but the organization. Another very large factor are the values of the organization and whether they're modeled by leadership. If leadership says one thing and does another, it undermines everything that's done. So that's all fine and good, right? We have work to do. And I want to share a couple of examples of cultural transformation that have happened by people just practicing these values, two of the most brutal environments on the planet. One took place in 1972, started in 1972, well before studies of employee engagement or any of these concepts were even talked about or considered. Back then, it was a very hierarchical, authority-driven management structure. This is the steel mill. Has anybody heard of Miracle at Pitron? Is that a movie anybody's ever heard? Or Stronger Than Steel? It's a book. Doesn't look like it. Pitron was a steel mill in Pennsylvania, racked by labor strife. Management and labor, the unions, they just hated each other. And this is an environment in Pennsylvania that probably goes back generations. Coal mining, steel making, union management strife was just ingrained for generations in these people. Wayne Alderson was a decorated infantryman in World War II. Won the Bronze Star, the Silver Star, the Combat Infantry Badge, numerous medals from foreign countries, badly injured in the war. So he's a tough man, a very courageous man. He was in finance at the mill and became VP of operations. And during an 84-day strike, bitter strike, is there any other kind than a bitter strike, 84-day strike, he was called on to lead the organization. And he went to the owner of Textron at the time, who owned the mill, who wanted his plan, and he presented his plan, and the general manager of Textron said, well, I don't see that's going to work. And he said, well, look, nothing else has worked. Let me try. If it doesn't work, you can fire me. And Wayne Alderson's approach was simply to demonstrate to people in the plant that he cared about them, that he valued them as people, treating them with love, dignity, and respect. That was his mantra, to treat them with love, dignity, and respect. And he did some very simple things to demonstrate that. First, he cleaned the windows in the plant and painted it. He wanted to have a nicer environment. Next, at the end of every shift, 3 shifts, end of every shift, he lived at the office. He would go to the gate and greet employees as they left and thank them for the work. Now imagine, I've thought about this scenario, how much courage this took to do. It's a steel mill, I imagine, sort of a grimy chain link fence, the gate. Employees, after 8 hours of brutal labor, are leaving. They hate your guts. And here's a guy in a suit at the gate saying thank you and shaking your hand. He said it took a couple weeks before people really began to look up and acknowledge him. He had to keep doing it. But over time, he learned every employee's name. He learned about their families, their kids. He could say, you know, how'd your son do on his test? How's Sally? Did she get better? Is, you know, did she lose her cough? How's the cold? So why, you know, he did these things. He reached out to the union president, who was a crane operator, and he did an office out of his crane, and he gave him an office in the building. He wanted to show the man respect. He gave him an office to work out of. He went down to the plant floor, found the dirtiest job there was, which is jackhammering steel off things. And he went down there, took off his coat, jackhammered for a few minutes, said, wow, you guys earned your money. Thank you. That spread throughout the plant. These simple acts of kindness. Now, he was no nonsense guy. He knew they were there to accomplish something. And you think about those soft values, I think that's the resistance to them. Well, yeah, we got work to do, though. Those are all well and good. We have work to do, but you can set the highest standards imaginable. You can hold people accountable to those standards. And you can discipline people, even fire them if you need to, but you can do so with compassion and kindness also. But people always respond better if you think the best of them and treat them that way. So what were the results? The results were really astonishing. In 21 months, sales went up 400%. Financials went from a deficit of $6 million to a profit of $6 million. The workforce grew from 300 to 1,200. Productivity rose 64%. Labor grievances went from 12 per week to 1 per year. Chronic absenteeism, running 20%, dropped to less than 1%. Quality of the product became the best in the history of the plant, and a poor safety record went to an outstanding one. And that is the power of treating people as people, as valuing them. But statistics say that 71% of employees in this country are disengaged. That means there's probably 300, 350 people here who aren't necessarily enjoying work the way that they could. And it really is largely managed responsibility, I think, to set that tone. Although I want to say that employees can make a big difference as well. So I want to tell you two stories about transformation. One was the steel mill, brutal environment. The second environment's even tougher than that, I think. And that's high school. And this is a boy, Josh. It's a video on YouTube. You can look it up. It's about 6 minutes long. It's had 5 million hits, so you know it strikes a chord with people. Kid Josh, very sensitive boy, whose father passed away, and he put pictures of his dad up in his locker to remember him. And kids, you know, being cruel as they are, tore the pictures down and just teased him mercilessly about his sensitivity, to the point that he had to leave the school. He went to a different school. And he wanted the experience in the other school to be different. And determined what he was going to do, something very simple. I don't know if he knew Wayne Alderson, but he decided he was going to greet kids at the front door every time they came into school. So he got there early every day to school, and he just greeted kids as they came in, held the door for them, welcomed them, said, have a good day. He became known as the door kid. And people thought he was a little strange at first. But over time, they began to respond to him. And they noticed it brightened their day to be greeted, wished a good day, smiled at. Every time you come to school, it's different. And if you talk to students and teachers at that school, they will tell you the school became a different place. It's a more upbeat place, a more positive place. People were kinder. And that's the value of just one person with no power in an environment making a difference because of the kindness that they show. But I think the corporate transformation starts with personal transformation. We know those values, we know they're important, but so often we don't do them. And it's a product of being too busy, it's a product of our upbringing, it's a product of our own issues, everybody's got issues. But the extent we can live on that side, the better off we are. And personal transformation is a big part of that. We've got to become better people, and that requires assistance, help. For me, faith made a big difference in my life. Knowing Jesus Christ and God, the creator of the universe, loves me and cares about me and wants to change me for the better, wants me to be the best version of myself, has made a big difference in my life and I think the lives of those around me. Me in my worst days, not pretty, and you want to minimize those. So I want to tell two stories of personal transformation that are intertwined. One is my dad. I mentioned he's a Navy guy. I worked for IBM for 20 years and had his own business. I love my dad, but he had his issues. You know, when he was born, his mother died giving birth to him. His father became an alcoholic. I really blamed him, I think, very abusive. He was rescued by his aunt and uncle, but that leaves scars. And my dad had a temper. He was an angry man much of the time, particularly if he'd been drinking. He never physically abused us, but he had a temper. And I will never forget the night he called the four boys together. We lived in Japan at the time, but we'd come home for the summer. It was after my eighth grade, so I was 13 years old. And I'm sure many people have had an experience like this. Dad called the family together, and he said, my three brothers and I, he said, boys, your mom and I have decided to get a divorce. I thought my world was ending, as many do. But we went back to Japan with my dad to let my parents live in separate rooms. My mom eventually took us back to the States. My dad stayed there with my older brother. The family was really torn apart. But I remember a year later, God got a hold of my dad in that year. I think he was so miserable that God was able to talk to him. A year later, he called us back together and he said, boys, I don't love your mother, but I know I'm not supposed to divorce her, and she's willing to work with me. So we're going to try to work this out. And that decision to do the right thing, even though I can't imagine how hard it was for both of them, has paid dividends in my life, my brother's lives, our kids' lives, and will for generations. I got to watch him grow for the next 30 years, become a different person. I was able to reconcile the issues we had with him. And I'll tell the story about my dad because it just reveals who he is. My dad had a great sense of humor. And he met adversity with humor. He'd had cancer. We had a lot of cancer in our family. My brother, my wife, my father, just so many people. And we would just sit around and joke and laugh till we cried. Tumor humor, my dad called it. So at age 62, he had cancer, bone marrow transplant, survived that. Recurrence of cancer 10 years later. And this was the night before he passed away. He was probably 85 pounds. I don't know. He was very thin and frail. And he and my mom became so close. The night before he died, he was sitting on my mom, their bed, just sort of hunched over and leaning against my mom. Mom's got her arm around him. My dad was a fighter, by the way. He was given 3 months to live. He made it 15 months. He wanted to make his 50th wedding anniversary and 20th Wood Day, which he did. But it's 2 months after the Wood Day, and the end is near. So he's sitting there with my mom, Greta. She's Danish, G-R-E-T-H-E, Greta. And he says to her, he goes, Greta, I don't think I'm going to make it this time. And she says, no, Alan, I don't think so. And he's quiet for a few seconds, and then he says, phooey. But the next day, he passed away at our house. His brothers are there. His family was there. That would never have happened if he hadn't made the decision he made to do the right thing. The other story of personal transformation is my own. I remember a couple distinct memories of sort of the impact of the upbringing on me. One was in my late 20s. I was reading, I don't know why I was reading, this article on adult children of alcoholics. And it's like 12 characteristics, and I'm reading this thing, and I'm going, oh, this is me. It's describing me. And I never knew. A lot of these traits were things that I took pride in. It's part of my character. And I said, this isn't me. This was done to me. And I went through a bit of identity crisis there. But I came back to the side realizing, yeah, these things were done to me, but they are strengths. And they've built into me things that could not be built into me any other way. My sensitivity to a room. You know, when you have an alcoholic parent, you listen to things like how the car door closes when your dad gets home. Because that's an indicator of the mood he's in. You, You can read the signals in conversation and the way people relate and the way they sit and the way they look. And it's a survival skill you have to develop. And these are strengths. If you're going to build culture, being able to read people is very important. So it's a lot of strengths that really came out of that. But one of the issues with adult children alcoholics is that you have a hard time connecting with people at an intimate level. It's just really hard to get close to them. And I, as I grew older, became aware of that in myself. I could never really get close to the people I wanted to, the way I wanted to. I always seemed to be a distance. I was also always aware that I was sort of keeping score. It was very important to me that people liked me, that they respected me. I'm a pathologically competitive person, as my golfing partners will tell you. But I didn't. I had to win. It wasn't either one. I had to win. I remember losing a game of cards to Laura early in our marriage. I have the best wife in the world. I lost at a game of cards. I lost at a game of cards to Laura, and I didn't talk to her for 3 days. Yeah. I'll get over it in a day now. I've gotten so much better. So I would keep score. You know, if I had a conversation with someone, I would go and replay it in my head, you know, and then I'd score it. Did I look good? Did I not look good? Did I make a mistake? Did I make a mistake? This, I couldn't stop it. It was just back there. And everything was like a score. And as I said, it's so important people liked me. And I went through a time in my life, and by the way, the tough times in your life, I know they're tough to get through, but they are the best times because that's when you grow the most. I don't care what you're going through. That, if it doesn't kill you, makes you stronger, is true, unfortunately, for us. But I went through a time in my life when I had really three main support structures in my life. One was church, one was my home, and the other was work. And at church, I was chairman of the elders board at the time of a different church, and we were going through a pastoral transition, which is never a happy time for anybody. And I was sort of leading that effort, and there were a lot of very unhappy people in the church. And so I was the focus of a lot of anger and dissatisfaction, which with my nature was very hard to deal with. At work, we were going through a transition also. We were really a very mom-and-pop-ish, highly reactive organization, and recognized we really need to become far more disciplined, far more proactive as an organization. It's a very difficult cultural change to make, particularly since I'm, by nature, a fly-by-the-seat-of-my-pants kind of person, and I collected a lot of people like that in the company. So over about an 18-month period, we had 12 people leave after having a very close-knit family environment. So it was a lot of anger there, a lot of discontent, a lot of dissatisfaction, people not understanding what was going on, why we were doing this. And at home, you know, every marriage has ups and downs, and I've had a great marriage, but this was probably the lowest point in our marriage before or since. So I had no support anywhere, and everywhere I looked, I saw people upset with me. I wasn't winning anywhere. The scoreboard was really lopsided, and it wasn't in my favor. This all came to a head one weekend, and something happened, I don't know what it was, but one of the things that I never did was I never showed anger. I think I was passive-aggressive, which is really much uglier than anger, but it was like this dam of 30 years pent-up rage broke. It was just the pressure had become too much. And I had to leave the house. I didn't want to hurt anybody. I just, and it wouldn't go away, just enraged and not knowing the source of it. I came back that night. I went to bed, and I'm still raging. At 2:00 in the morning, I'm still raging. The whole time I'm praying, I'm asking God, what is going on? I don't know what to do with this. I don't know how to get rid of it. I don't know what you're doing. Can you just please tell me what's going on and help me deal with this? And it was about 2:00 in the morning when God showed me, and God can do this kind of thing. God showed me a picture of myself, a very clear picture of myself as a little boy. I was probably 7 or 8 years old. I was lying in bed crying bitterly because my dad had punished me for something. As I said, he had a temper. He never hit us. We had a very bad temper. I'd probably left a tool out in the rain or something, you know, little kids do. And I was crying bitterly, and I made a vow. I saw myself making this vow that I was going to be perfect, That was going to be my protection against the world. I was never going to give anybody reason to think poorly of me or be angry with me or be disappointed with me. If I was perfect, I could accomplish that. But of course, no one can be perfect. So what you end up doing is you begin to engineer appearing perfect. And if you're going to appear perfect and manage that, you have to keep score, right? You can't manage it, you can't measure. So this is why the scoreboard's back there all the time. I had to keep score. And it wasn't until God put me in a position where I could not win that he was able to deal with that. So he showed me that picture, showed me making the vow, and then he broke it, as only God can do. And the other side of that, I would say the scoreboard is dark. There's no scoreboard. I can talk to people. I can be myself. I don't have to worry about how they're thinking about me or what they're thinking. It is a wonderful place to be, and I'm so grateful for the opportunity to do that. I do believe God wants us to be the best versions of ourselves. He created us all as beautiful people, and he thinks we are beautiful people. He believes in us, and he wants to change us if we'll let him. Now, what I find after this prayer breakfast, when I talk to people, is people often leave inspired to be better people. It's a brighter day, even though it's raining. The sun's out. You know, this is, we can make a difference. But what happens over time is it kind of runs down, right? It might last a day, a week, a month, 2 months, but it sort of runs down. Someone explained to me why that is once. They said it's because vision leaks, right? You put your vision in a bucket and it's full, but it leaks out the bottom. Unless you're filling the bucket, it leaks and you run down and you've lost momentum. So what we want to do, we've had this prayer breakfast once a year to talk about these kinds of things. What I'd like to do is offer the opportunity to meet on a quarterly basis. There's a response card actually on your table. And you can express a preference to meet for a breakfast meeting or lunch meeting. It will take shape after we hear back from people. But if this is something you'd like to do, to get together more frequently, then we're not going to have the music and all that stuff. It's just going to be get together and we'll talk about things. But we want to explore these issues of cultural transformation and faith in the workplace, faith in our lives, how we become better people, how we bring those values into work to transform work. If that's of interest to you, we'd like to just please fill out the card and turn it in. I have no idea what kind of response we'll get, but it'll be something where you probably take $10 and cover the meal and we'll get together. So please do that before you go. That is really it. I am so blessed to be able to talk to you. I love this community. I see so many people in this room that I know and respect and love, and it's just such a privilege to be able to talk to you. Thank you very much.